My name is Joseph John. The topic I am going to cover is bipolar junction transistor. So this is would be a very basic topic. There will be two lectures on transistors. The first one is an introductory lecture. The second one, which will be held next week, will go into the details of common emitter amplifier. Now, bipolar junction transistor was invented in 1948, and as you may be aware, a Nobel Prize was awarded for that. And since then, this particular invention led to the era of solid state circuits and also integrated circuits. And till early 80s, BJT, as it is called, was the device of choice in the design of both discrete and integrated circuits. Today, MOSFET is the most widely common used, but still in some applications, BJT is still the device of choice. Now, coming to the basic structure of a BJT, BJT is a three terminal device, which needs automatically that it needs at least two characteristics to characterize it, and it has three semiconductor regions: emitter, base and collector regions. The transistor consists of has two junctions, the emitter base junction and the collector base junction. We will see more of it soon. Now, in the last lecture by Professor Sharma, he talked about the charge carriers, both electrons and holes. Now, in a BJT, both electrons and holes are involved, and hence the name bipolar junction transistor. In an NPN transistor, it has an N-type emitter, a P-type base and an N-type collector, whereas a PNP transistor has a P-type emitter, an N-type base and a P-type collector. Now, what you have here is just the basic structure. So, the first one is a PNP transistor. You can see a P-type emitter, an N-type base and a P-type collector, and this is the symbol of a PNP transistor. This arrow here indicates the actual direction of current. So, this is the emitter current flows into the device, and both the base and the collector currents leaves the device. An NPN transistor has an N-type emitter, a P-type base and an N-type collector, and the symbol for an NPN transistor is shown here. Here again the arrow indicates the actual direction of current. In an NPN transistor, the emitter current flows out of the device, whereas both base current and collector current flows into the device. Now, if you look a bit more detail into the collector, emitter and the base regions, the collector has the largest area in a BJT. This is to take care of the power dissipation requirement due to large current and large the collector base junction voltage, and emitter has slightly less than the collector, and this is because the emitter base junction has lower junction voltage. Base is made very thin to minimize recombination. Now, in terms of doping, we heard Professor Sharma's in the last lecture about doping. Now, the emitter junction, emitter region is heavily doped, while the base region is lightly doped. Collector has a doping somewhere in between the emitter and the base. Now, coming to the modes of operation of a BJT, there are four modes of operation. We can see them the way it is shown here. There are two junctions, so there are four possibilities. Now, if you look at one of the possibilities, if you reverse bias both the junctions, that is the emitter base junction and the collector base junction, we can think of the device being cut off. Now, active mode is the most commonly used mode, and that is the most desirable for amplifiers and other applications. Now, in this particular case, for an active mode of operation, you need to keep the emitter base junction forward biased while the collector base junction should be reverse biased. Now, in switching applications and so on, you occasionally have the saturation mode also. In this particular case, both the emitter base and the collector base junctions get forward biased. There is another mode of operation which is very, very seldom used, yet there are applications, especially in logic circuits such as TTL gates, and TTL logic uses this particular mode of operation. This is what is called the reverse active. The previous active mode is actually called forward active mode. This is called reverse active. Now, if you look here, essentially this, in this particular case, the emitter base junction is reverse biased, while the collector base junction is forward biased. This is just the, you can think of the reverse active mode as an interchanging of emitter and collector junctions in terms of the forward active mode. What I will do is, we will spend almost 45 to 1 hour on the basics of a BJT, and then we will take some numerical examples to illustrate the problem, the basic operation. Now, coming to the operation of an NPN transistor in the active mode, now you would see that most of the circuits which you would come across make use of an NPN transistor. Very seldom would come across a PNP transistor. However, there are applications where you use PNP also. Now, what we have here is, what we have shown here is a basic kind of a block schematic of an NPN transistor. Now, here this the left side is the emitter region, the middle you have the base region, and then you have the collector region on the right side. And the emitter base junction is forward biased, which means you would see that the base, this being an NPN transistor, so the base would have more positive voltage compared to the emitter. And the collector base junction is reverse bias, which means the collector would be applied a more positive voltage as compared to the base. And as you would see from the biasing shown here in terms of two batteries, you would see that the voltage which you apply to the base emitter junction is much smaller compared to the voltage you apply to the reverse bias which you apply to the collector base junction. Now, coming to the currents in a BJT, the emitter current, as we saw from the previous diagram, the emitter is heavily doped, and this is an n-type region. And when you forward bias the emitter base junction, what happens is you have carriers electrons injected from the emitter into the base. Simultaneously, you also have holes injected from the base into the emitter, and both these constitute the emitter current. But as we know, the doping of the emitter is much higher than the doping of the base. Hence, you could say that the emitter current is mostly consisting of the electron current due to the electrons. Now, once they are the injector electrons reach the base region, they diffuse towards the collector base junction. Now, base is made extremely thin, because you would like to minimize loss of carriers there. Now, since the electrons are minority carriers in the base region, some of them recombine, and so the base current is due to, has two components. One component is due to the injected holes from base to emitter. The other component is due to the holes need to be supplied due to the recombination. Now, the diffusing electrons, once they reach the reverse bias junction, the collector base junction, they are swept away, and the depletion region, they are swept away into the collector, and that constitutes the current. Since the current, emitter current, is basically due to electrons being injected from the emitter to the base, the actual direction of current would be the opposite of the electron flow. So, in actual case, in an NPN transistor, you would have the emitter current flowing out of the emitter, base current flowing into the base, and the collector current flowing into the collector terminal. So, we have seen briefly these three currents, the emitter current, the collector current and the base current, and their constituents and how they actually flow. There is another important current, which is a very basic device parameter for a BJT, which is called the saturation current. Now, this saturation current in our equations, which we would see later, would be indicated as I subscript S. This current is also called a scale current. This is for the reason that the current, this particular current is proportional, directly proportional to the area of the emitter base junction. So, larger the area, larger would be the value of I s. At the same time, I s is inversely proportional to the base width. Typical range of I s is between 10 power minus 12 to about 10 power minus 18 amps. Now, having seen the currents, let us look at the kind of relationships between these three currents. Now, the forward bias voltage between the base and the emitter causes first the injection of carriers into the base and subsequently a collector current. Now, this current which is flowing, the collector current can be expressed as IC equal to IS times e to the power VB by VT, where VB is the forward bias voltage and VT is the thermal voltage, which is typically about 26 millivolt at room temperature. Now, for an NPN transistor, as we saw earlier, the emitter current leaves the device, whereas the collector current and the base current both enters the device. Therefore, applying Kirchhoff's current law, we can write IE, which is the emitter current, is equal to collector current plus base current. Now, this is one of the fundamental current equations and is always valid irrespective of which mode of operation the BJT is operating. Now, we can write another expression which as IB, the base current, is equal to IC by beta, or IC is equal to beta times IB, where beta is called the common emitter current gain. We will see later why this name. Now, since IC is much greater than IB, beta is much greater than unity. Now, again using the previous equations, we can write another equation for IE in terms of IC, that is emitter current. We can write an expression for emitter current in terms of the collector current as beta plus 1 by beta times IC. Now, combining this, we can write IC as alpha times IE, where alpha is beta by beta plus 1. Now, alpha is called the common base current gain. Since IC is less than IC, sorry, since IE is less than IC, alpha will always be less than 1. Now, we could have a relationship between beta and alpha. So, it is written as beta will be equal to alpha by 1 minus alpha. Since beta would be typically of the order of typically from about 50 to about 200 or so, most of the time you would see that alpha will be almost equal to unity. Now, alpha and beta, as they are normally written, are the current gains in the forward active mode. Occasionally, they are also denoted as alpha subscript f and beta subscript f to indicate that they belong to the forward active mode. Now, so as I said, the beta can be anywhere between 50 to 400, and if beta is 100, then alpha would be 0.9901. Now, we could combine the previous equation which we wrote two equations, equations 1 and 5, and we can write an expression for I e as I s by alpha times e to the power V b by V t. Now, the previous equation we had was I c equal to I s times e to the power V b by V t, and we know that I e is equal to I c by alpha, hence this relation. Now, we could just summarize what we did so far. Now, what we said is, in a forward bias voltage V b applied between the emitter and base causes an exponentially rising collector current I c to flow in the collector terminal. The collector terminal the collector current I c is independent of the value of the collector voltage as long as the collector base junction is reverse biased. Now, therefore, we can say that in the active mode, the collector terminal behaves as a controlled current source, where V b controls the current. We also said the collector current is a fraction of the emitter current, and we said again beta f is much greater than unity, whereas alpha f is approximately equal to unity. Now, to make calculations and current calculations and to understand it better, we could come up with a model for the forward active mode NPN transistor. What we have here shown here in the figure 3 is a large signal model. Later, when we talk about amplifiers, we will talk about small signal model. So, here we are talking about these models can be used for say kind of DC values or large signals. So, what you have here is the NPN transistor in the figure 3a here is shown. You can see the collector terminal here, the base terminal here, the emitter terminal here. The base to emitter junction is shown as a diode, and you have the V b voltage applied as a forward bias, and you have a current source here which is a controlled current source having a current I s into the e to the power V b by V t. This is the current we wrote earlier. So, this particular kind of a model is a voltage controlled current source. We could write, we could modify this into a current controlled current source as the way shown here. You could see that here the control parameter would be I e, which is the emitter current, and the controlled current source would be alpha f times I e. What is important to notice here is that the controlled current source we have is a nonlinear current source, because we have an exponential relationship. Now, we can think of BJT as a two port network. Coming back to the diagram, we could see that we could think of the BJT as a two port network having an input port. In this case, you could think of the BE as the between base to emitter as the input port and collector to emitter as the output port. So, this you can think of a BJT as a two port device. Now, since we have now that we have studied forward active mode in some detail, we could look at the actual structure of a BJT. Now, what we have in figure 4 is the typical cross section of an NPN transistor. We see here the outer portion here is the collector. You could see emitter being surrounded by base and which is surrounded by collector. As we saw earlier, the collector region, collector is the largest region, and you see that the way it is constructed, almost all the electrons which are injected into the base gets collected because of this kind of a structure. One very important thing to notice here is that the even though both emitter and collector are both n type semiconductor material, the actual area is very very different. Let us look at now the reverse active mode. Now, in a reverse active mode, as we discussed earlier, we can think of reverse active mode, which is very seldom used, as a case where a special case of the forward active mode, where the base and the the collector and the emitter terminals getting interchanged. Now, as we saw just now, since BJT is not symmetrical, the current gains which you would get in a reverse active mode, you would see would be very different from the current gains you have alpha f and beta f. Now, since BJT is optimized for forward active mode operation, alpha r and beta r, which are the current gains in the reverse active mode, would be much lower compared to alpha f and beta f. However, alpha r and beta r are related by the same equations which we wrote earlier for alpha f and beta f. So, typically alpha r would be in the range of 0.01 to 0.5 and the corresponding range of beta r would be 0.01 to 1. If you compare this with the values of alpha f, we said alpha f is approximately unity and beta f we said is typically 100 or so. So, you could see that alpha r and beta r are much, much smaller than alpha f and beta f. Now, we could attempt a large signal model for the NPN transistor in the reverse active mode. Now, to do this, we could there is a very simple relationship which connects the scale currents. Now, in the large signal model, the diode which we used for the forward active mode, we used a diode called DE. Now, in the reverse active mode, we would use, since the collector base junction is forward biased and the base emitter junction is reverse bias, we would use a diode DC to represent the forward bias diode. Now, the scale current for the that particular diode ISC would be IS by alpha r, and we know that alpha r is much less than unity. Therefore, we would see that the ISC, the scale current for this particular diode, would be much higher than the diode which we use in the other model for the forward active mode. Now, these scale currents are related by a simple relationship: alpha f times ISC is equal to alpha r times ISC equals IS. Now, one important thing to notice here is that because of the large ISC, which is a scale current, the same current, for the same current in the collector base junction, you would need only much lower voltage drop, forward biased drop, compared to the emitter base junction. Now, this particular phenomena has a lot of implication when you talk about the saturation mode of a transistor. So, in the large signal model of the NPN transistor is shown here. Now, since now that we have seen the forward active mode and the reverse active mode in some detail, we could now talk about, we could come up with a model which models the NPN transistor in all its possible modes. Now, Ebers mold model or the EM model is one such model where the NPN transistor can be modeled to predict the operation in all its possible modes. This particular model is nothing but a combination of the last two large signal models we used. You could see, we will see that the only difference is the currents have been rewritten slightly. Now, so what we have, this is the base terminal, you have the collector terminal and the emitter terminal, and you can see the NPN transistor emitter current is leaving, base current is entering and the collector current is also entering the device. And applying KCL, we can write three expressions. We will not go into great detail. Now, the advantage of the Ebers mold model is that we could predict the currents. So, we could write IE from the I E as I D E minus alpha R times I D C, I C as minus of I D C plus alpha F I D E, and I B as 1 minus alpha F I D E plus 1 minus alpha R I D C. Now, if we substitute values for I D C and I D E as I D E is equal to I S E times e to the power V B by V T minus 1, and I D E this should be I D C. We would see that these expressions, we would get detailed expressions for all the three currents. Now, these equations look very complicated, but if you look at it carefully, we would see, let us look at these two terms, look at the collector current, let us look at the first two terms. Now, the first term as an exponential term e to the power V B by V T, and the second term you have an exponential term e to the power V B C by V T. So, you could think of the above small equation showing you the terminal currents as a sum of two currents. For example, the collector current is basically the sum of the forward biased emitter base junction and the forward biased collector base junction. Now, in the normal forward active mode, we know that the base collector junction is reverse bias, which means E V B C would be negative. So, we would see that this entire second term would disappear. So, we would see the collector current being governed just by the emitter to base junction forward biased. So, these two, these equations can be used to find the values of current for all possible cases. Now, these equations give a very good understanding of the active and the saturation modes of an NPN transistor. Now, the active mode of a BJT is fairly well understood. However, the saturation mode is one of the most complicated and most misunderstood, and above small model gives you a very good understanding, and it shows you when a device is saturated and when it is active. Now, from the as I said in the previous in the above small equations, if you consider the forward bias case, that corresponds to the base emitter junction being forward bias, which means V B will be positive, and the base collector base junction being reverse bias, which means the base to collector voltage would be negative. This is because of the reason that we saw earlier, that the collector potential would be always much, much more positive than base, with the result that V B C would be negative, with the result the entire term the entire exponential term will disappear, and that way the current in an active mode is governed only by the first term, and a very similar thing you would find the emitter current also. Now, one of the best ways of understanding the saturation mode is to plot the above small equation for the IC. If you plot IC as a function of VCB for a given, what we have here is a plot of the expression for IC for a particular value of VB. For VB is equal to 0.7. What we are doing here is we are changing VCB all the way from minus 0.75 to plus, let us say, 2.5 volts. Now, as generally when we say forward biased, we said that in the forward active mode, the collector base junction should be reverse biased. Now, what do you mean by reverse bias? Now, what we see from here is that the current, the collector current does not change at all, even till up to the about minus 0.4 volt. This is because of the reason that even though collector to base voltage is reduced, till the collector to or the base to collector voltage becomes forward active more than about 0.5 volt, that particular junction is not properly forward biased, with the result that till about 0.4 volt of forward bias to the base to collector junction, the second term in the previous equation which we saw has no effect. Therefore, we can safely say that as long as we ensure that the collector voltage, so we can ensure that the we are able to keep the collector voltage down to even up to about minus 0.4 with compared to the base, we would still be in the active region. Now, from the some of we will see later some expressions to illustrate this. Now, above small model we can use to explain the other model, other modes of operation also. The reverse active mode we said is a case where the collector base junction is forward biased and the emitter base junction is reverse biased. Now, in the same previous equations, if we put the appropriate values, that is forward biasing the collector base junction and reverse biasing, we can get currents in the reverse active mode. Now, in the cutoff mode, again in the above small model, if you substitute one case, if you reverse bias both emitter base junction and the collector base junction, we would see that the collector current would be negligible, or this will be the case even if you make VB less than 0.5 also, you would see the collector current would be negligible. So, therefore, we find that the above small equations give you a very fairly accurate large signal model as far as the transistor operation is concerned, and using above small equations, you could compute all the currents in all kinds of voltages. Today itself, I will be uploading a home assignment for your own use, where I am asking you to calculate some of this, so that you can actually see transistor in all kinds of possible modes. Having seen the NPN transistor in detail, let us have a quick look at the PNP transistor. Now, in a PNP transistor, we have the emitter region as a P material, made of P material. You have a N material for the base and another P material for the collector. Now, in a PNP transistor, the emitter, since you have to forward bias the emitter base junction, the emitter would be kept at a higher potential compared to the base. Now, since we have to reverse bias the collector base junction, the collector would be kept at a much more negative voltage compared to the base. Now, here the current flow in a PNP transistor can be thought of as injection of holes from the emitter into the base, as opposed to the injection of electrons in the case of the NPN transistor. Now, since emitter is heavily doped and base is lightly doped, we would see that the injected holes from emitter to base would be much, much higher than the injected electrons from the base to emitter. And since the direction of holes would be the same as the direction of current in a PNP transistor, the actual direction of emitter current would be into the device, and the direction of the base current and the collector current would be out of the device. Now, we could apply the above small equations for the PNP transistor also, just by replacing VB in those equations by VEB and VBC by VCB. Now, we have, since we have seen BJT in kind of fairly greater detail, let us look at the BJT configurations. Now, these BJT configurations are quite important when we talk about amplifiers, and in my next lecture on BJT common emitter amplifier, we look at this in some detail. Now, the why do we have different BJT configurations? As we saw earlier, we said that a BJT can be thought of as a two-port network. The device can be thought of as a two-port network, with since there are three terminals, you can have one terminal as the common terminal for both the input and the output ports. So, you have three possibilities. Let us look at the common emitter configuration. So, what we have listed in this particular table is basically shown the common terminal, the input port and the output port. Now, in a common emitter configuration, emitter terminal will be the common terminal. So, the input would be between base and emitter, and the output port would be between collector and emitter. Now, hence the word common emitter. In a common base configuration, base would be the terminal which is common to both the input and the output ports, and in the common collector configuration, the collector terminal would be the common terminal between the input and the output port. Now, we earlier saw the current gains alpha and beta. Now that we have some understanding of the BJT configurations, alpha is called the common base current gain, as we saw earlier. Now, alpha also we wrote earlier as IC by IE. Now, we saw in the common base configuration, the input port is between emitter and base, and the input current is the emitter current, and the output is between the collector and base, and the output current is the collector current. Therefore, alpha can be thought of as a kind of a transfer parameter. So, output current by input current, and hence the name common base current gain. Similarly, we saw earlier, we saw beta, and beta was called the common emitter current gain, and again here we know that in a common emitter configuration, the input current would be the base current and the output current would be the collector current. Therefore, the transfer parameter here is IC by IB, and hence the name common emitter current gain. Now, later when we talk about amplifiers, we will see that when BJT is used as amplifiers in these three configurations, they would have very different performance parameters. We will see that in detail later. Now, at the moment, now that we have understood to some extent the operation of a BJT and the modes of operation as well as the basic configurations, let us look at the current voltage characteristics to get some more insight. Now, two voltage characteristics are in common use, and generally they are called the input and the output characteristics to describe the operation of a BJT in the chosen configuration. The most commonly used configuration is the common emitter configuration. So, we shall see the current voltage characteristics in the common emitter configuration. There are two characteristics. First one is the input characteristic, where we would plot the base current, which is the input current, as a function of the input voltage VBE, and in the output characteristic, we would plot IC, the collector current, as a function of the output voltage VCE. Let us first look at the input characteristic, which is the base current versus VBE. Now, from our previous equations, we saw that we can write IB as IS divided by beta F times e to the power VBE by VT. You might remember that we had written earlier IC as IS times e to the power VBE by VT. Therefore, the expression divided by beta F would give you IB. A typical plot of IB versus VB is shown here, and we could see here an exponential relationship. What is interesting to see here is that we earlier, when we talked about active mode, we said that till about 0.5 volt hardly any current flows, and we can see here that when VB is 0.5, the current is extremely small, and you could see that any appreciable current flows only when the forward bias voltage VBE exceeds 0.6. Now, the most commonly used forward bias voltage is 0.7, which you can see here very well, that at 0.7 volts you have appreciable base current. So, for most of the DC calculations we would use 0.7 as the as a first order approximation for the VBE voltage. Another very important thing to remember, as we know, as we can see, the input characteristic is nothing but a diode characteristic, and just like a normal diode, the BJT is also highly sensitive to temperature variations, and we would see that the VB will decrease by 2 millivolt per degree centigrade rise in temperature if the junction is operating at a constant current, which means that as temperature increases, for lesser and lesser VB voltage you would get the same current. This particular feature is used these days very extensively for making sensors, very cheap sensors. So, we can use a simple diode as a very good sensor, temperature sensor. If you could pass a constant current through a diode and just monitor the voltage across it, we would see that for every 1 degree rise in temperature, the voltage across the diode would decrease by 2 millivolt. So, this principle is used in diode sensors, and we would see that input characteristics also would have a very similar behavior. Let us now come to the output characteristic, where the collector current is plotted as a function of the VCE, which is the output voltage. Now, here what we have plotted here is the collector current as a the value of the collector current for various values of base currents. Now, if the base current is 0, which corresponds to the x axis, the corresponding collector current will be 0, but as we keep increasing base current, let us say IB1, we would get a particular value of IC and so on. So, we could choose any value of IB for our operation. Let us assume that we would use use the BJT to operate at a certain point, say Q. Now, we could find the operating point or the corresponding IC and VC at that point as VCEQ and ICQ. One very important thing to notice from this particular graph is that we see that once the VCE exceeds a certain voltage, we see that the current is almost constant, but we see a small slope here, we will talk about it later. Otherwise, we would see that as a first order approximation, we would see that the current is almost constant once you exceed a certain voltage. At the same time, we see that below a certain value of VCE, we see that the current drops. Now, this particular dividing line is the dividing line between the saturation region and the active region. Now, so in the saturation region, as VCE keeps decreasing, you would see that the current would also keep decreasing. This can be easily seen from the above small equations. Now, the typically this particular value of VCE at the kind of dividing line between active region and saturation region is typically in DC circuits, we would use that to be about 0.2 volts, and it is called the VCE sat or the VCE saturation voltage. Now, let us talk about the current gain, the common emitter current gain. Now, beta DC is defined as the current which we had the collector current divided by the base current at the particular quiescent point Q, which we saw earlier. Now, this particular current gain is also called the large signal gain, large signal beta or the DC beta, and it is often written as beta DC. We can also define another parameter, which is the incremental or AC beta. We can write this as the as delta IC by delta IB for a particular value of VCE. Coming back to the diagram, we can see that at this particular, let us say at this particular value of VCE, if we go from say IB equal to IB 3 to IB is equal to IB 4, we get delta IB here. Now, if we measure the corresponding change in the collector current, we get delta IC. So, we can find beta AC as delta AC, delta IC by delta IB at a particular value of VCE. Now, we would see that the values of beta DC and beta AC differ by typically about 10%. So, most of the time the distinction is not made between beta DC and beta AC, the value of simple beta is written. Occasionally in some models you will also find beta being written as HFE. This comes from the hybrid parameter model, and HFE is called the short circuit common emitter current gain. Having seen the characteristics, now let us talk about another important behavior which we can see of BJTs, which you can see from these particular characteristics. We said that above VCE sat, which is the dividing line between the saturation region and the active region, we said that the IC VCE characteristic has a certain positive slope. Now, if you extrapolate this, you would see that this line would meet the negative axis, the x axis at a certain point. Now, at that particular point, if you denote that as say a particular voltage, let us say VA, that is called the early voltage. So, what we are trying to see from the transistor is that as you, even though we said earlier that the collector current is independent of the VCE, but what we are seeing here is that actually the collector current keeps increasing as we keep increasing VCE. Now, this particular voltage which you get by extrapolating the characteristic to the x axis, and you generally write it by a voltage called VA, which is a particular which depends on fabrication of the transistor, and it is a particular parameter for a particular BJT, and typically this will be in the range of 50 to 200 volts. Now, VA is called the early voltage, and this particular effect is early effect. Now, if you look at early effect, we could maybe take a minute to explain why current increased when we increased VCE. We know that VCE, which is the voltage between the collector and the emitter, is VBE, which is the voltage between the base and the emitter, plus the voltage between the collector and the base VCB. So, if we increase VCE for a given VBE, because VBE will be typically let us say 0.7. So, if we keep increasing VCE, we would see that that amounts to increasing VCB, which is the reverse bias voltage. Now, when we increase the reverse bias, the depletion region width reduces. Now, this would effectively reduce the width of the base. Earlier we saw that the scale current IS, we said it is inversely proportional to the base width. So, since here the base width is reducing, the IS value would increase. This would give you a proportionate increase in IC. So, this effect is called early effect, and most of the calculations we would generally neglect early effect. However, in models we would use it. Now, having seen the basic operation of BJT, in some detail. Let us look at some examples. One of the best circuits which I found from my own teaching career in explaining especially the different modes of a transistor in terms from a circuit is the BJT inverter circuit. So, we will use the BJT inverter circuit to illustrate the meaning of cutoff, active and saturation modes in an actual circuit and also the interplay between them. So, here what we would assume that the VBE with the forward bias voltage would be 0.7, we would assume a beta of about 50 and a VC sat voltage of 0.2. So, essentially what we have is a, this is a BJT inverter circuit where you would apply a input voltage to the base through a resistor and you have a collector resistance here. So, we would apply input between the base and the emitter, you would see output from between collector and ground and the emitter is here grounded here. This is an extremely useful and a simple circuit to explain all these three modes. Now, initially let us consider the first case, let us assume that. So, effectively we will vary V1 which or the V in voltage here all the way from 0 all the way to VCC. As we go from 0 to VCC, let us see what happens to the transistor and also let us see what happens to the output voltage. Now, initially let us assume that your V in is less than VBE. So, since VBE is 0.7, you would see that as long as you keep the input less than 0.7, the base to emitter junction is not getting forward biased. Therefore, no base current will flow. Since there is no base current, there will be no collector current. Since there is no collector current, we would see that the output voltage would be the same as the supply voltage. So, this is the first case which is very easy to understand. So, this illustrates the one of the modes which we talked about earlier, which is the cutoff mode, which means effectively the base is not getting, the base to emitter junction is not getting forward biased. And even though you have a proper reverse bias for the collector to base junction, the transistor is off. So, this shows the BJT in the cutoff mode. Now, let us increase the voltage applied to the between base and emitter. Now, as we increase it beyond VBE, we would see that a base current would start flowing. Now, let us increase it till a particular voltage we will name as VIH. We will look at this particular voltage later and how to get it. But one very important thing to remember is that as we keep increasing V in beyond VBE, the BJT would turn on. And now we can write an expression for the base current as V in minus VBE by R1. Let us look at the circuit again. So, if you apply Kirchhoff's voltage law in the base to emitter loop, we would see that V in is equal to IB times R1 plus VBE, from where we can write IB as V in minus VBE by R1. Now, once we get IB, we can get IC as beta times IB. Now, in the output loop, again if you apply Kirchhoff's voltage law, we would see that VCC is equal to IC times R2 plus VCE. Here VCE is same as V out or VO. So, in the output loop, VCC is equal to IC R2 plus VCE, or V out which is same as VCE would be nothing but VCC minus IC R2. Hence, as V in increases, V out will keep decreasing. Now, the issue is how low can V out or VC become? Can it become 0? Can it become negative? Now, this is a point at which generally students would have lot of questions and lot of confusion. Now, this is where we need to spend some time in explaining what is the limit on that particular voltage. Now, we saw earlier from the IC VC characteristics in the common emitter configuration. And as we would have noticed, the BJT inverter circuit we just now drew, which we considered, is actually a common emitter configuration. Emitter is grounded, input is between base and emitter, output is between collector and emitter. Now, since we know it very well from the characteristics that since it is a common emitter configuration, Vc is definitely greater than 0, we saw that in the characteristics. So, that answers one question that Vc cannot be negative. Now, we need to see whether what is that voltage. Now, what we saw also that even though it is greater than 0, we saw that there is a region up to which the both the junctions get forward biased, and we said in the, that is the region we called as the saturation region, where both voltages get forward biased. Now, let us understand this from the transistor. So, this voltage is VCE between the collector and the emitter terminals. We see that we wrote this expression earlier also. So, we can see applying KVL that VCE is equal to VBE plus VCB. Therefore, we know that to start with VCB, since it was a reverse bias, VCB was positive to start with, VB was anyway positive. And we know that to start with, since VCB was reverse bias voltage, it was much greater than VBE. But as IC increases, the potential VC or VCE will keep decreasing and VCB will keep decreasing. Now, the lowest value of VCE possible for an NPN transistor is VC sat, which we saw in the characteristic, which is typically in the range of 50 to 200 millivolt. And we said for most DC calculations, we would assume it to be 0.2 volt or 200 millivolt. So, one, this is one very important observation or thing to notice here is that VC cannot be negative in an NPN transistor. So, now that we know the smallest value possible for VCE, now we can calculate the maximum possible value of collector current that we can find as, this is the same KVL we wrote. So, we said that in the output loop, IC is equal to VCC minus VC by R2, since the lowest value of VC is VC sat, the maximum value of IC is IC max is VCC minus VC sat by R2. So, that gives us the maximum possible value. Since it is from KVL, this is the this is a value which cannot change. Now, the value at which V out first becomes VC sat, the corresponding VI value is what we will call as VIH. Now, how do we calculate VIH? So, we will call VIH the input voltage at which output first becomes VC sat. How do we calculate that? Now, we can calculate that by calculating the maximum base current, rather the base current corresponding to this IC max, that we can find as IC max by beta. If we call that IB2, now we know that IB is equal to Vin minus VB by R1, and here we can substitute IB as IB2 and get VIH as VB plus IB2 times R2. Now, what we have here is a plot of the BJT inverter. So, we saw earlier that up to about 0.7 volts, the BJT was in cutoff, therefore, the output was fully VCC. And we said that once the input voltage, so here we have x axis V in, y axis V out, which is same as VC. So, this is the BJT inverter transfer characteristics. Now, we said that once V in increased above VBE, we said the output dropped, and this drops linearly. This is because of the reason that V out is equal to VCC minus ICRC, is a linear relationship, and we said the minimum it can reach is VC sat, and that particular input value, voltage value, we will call as VIH. So, we see that this particular second region is the active, now the BJT is operating in the active region. So, now we already seen two modes of operation, cutoff and active. So, we can say that as long as V in is between VB and VIH, the BJT is in the active mode. And for this range, IC varies linearly with IB. Now, let us consider the third case, that is V in is greater than VIH, that particular VIH value where we had the it first reached VC sat. Now, we know that once you V in is beyond V I h, I b will keep increasing, because I b is equal to V in minus V b by R 1, because that is the KVL. So, I b will keep increasing, but I c cannot increase, because we wrote I c as the maximum value of I c. So, we see that I c gets clamped at I c is equal to I c max, and also V naught cannot decrease. We said that is the minimum voltage can reach. So, it will get clamped to V c sat. So, this is called the saturation region. So, as we wrote earlier, V c would be equal to V b plus V c b, or V c b is equal to V c minus V b. Now, V b is 0.7, V c sat is 0.2. Therefore, we can find V c b to be minus 0.5, or V b c is plus 0.5. So, we see here that both the base emitter and the collector base junction, or the emitter base and the collector base junction, are forward biased. So, this is indeed the saturation region which you talked about. So, we see two interesting features of the saturation mode. One thing is, in saturation mode the IC value would be less than IB times beta DC value. Now, the second thing is, both the emitter base and the collector base junctions gets forward biased. So, this particular circuit is an extremely useful circuit, especially for teaching students the modes of a transistor for the first time, after talking about the basic relationships to explain, and that most of the time clarifies the doubts. Maybe we may have to go over it a few times. And I have included a BJT inverter problem in the home assignment. So, you will also have another chance to work it out for yourself and understand. So, I hope you would take time to do the home assignment problem. Now, let us spend a little bit of time on the last circuit I have, which is again an extremely important circuit, the common emitter biasing circuit. This particular circuit clarifies again lot of doubts about biasing, and about especially about active mode and saturation mode. What I plan to do is, next 15 minutes, roughly 10 minutes, I will spend some time on this circuit, and we will keep about 10 minutes for any quick questions you might have. So, let us spend another 10 minutes on this particular circuit. Now, here what we have, this is the most commonly used biasing circuit for a common emitter amplifier, which we will discuss in the next lecture. Now, given a circuit like this, how do we calculate all the currents and all node voltages? Most of the time, as we saw in the IC VC characteristics, all that we need to calculate is the IC value and the VC value. Now, this particular circuit can be simplified using Thevenin's theorem. Again, this is one of the most one of the common confusion which students have, given a circuit like this, how to simplify it. Now, Thevenin's theorem is one of the most elegant theorem. So, again I very commonly use this as an example of how Thevenin's theorem makes the circuit very simple. If somebody tries to solve this particular try to find the current, the base current through node equations, you would need at least two equations, whereas here a single one equation you can solve it. Now, what we have here, we applied Thevenin's theorem between the base and the emitter terminal, or the base and the ground, not emitter, between base and the ground. So, what Thevenin's theorem says is, open this particular port, look towards the side, find the open circuit voltage, that will be the Thevenin voltage. So, the open circuit voltage here VBB is nothing but VCC times R2 by R1 plus R2. Now, the Thevenin resistance will be the parallel combination of R1 and R2. So, the circuit now reduces to a very simple circuit, where calculation of currents becomes very simple. So, this is the first step in solving this particular circuit. So, once we do this by writing, getting VBB and RB, once we do that, now we need to, in all transistor circuits, before we solve it, especially this kind of biasing circuits, you need to make an assumption. Since there are many unknowns here, the best way to solve it is to by making an assumption that the BJT is in the active mode. Why is it so? The moment I assume that the BJT is in the active mode, I can use the relationship between collector current and base current as IC is equal to beta times IB. So, if I find IB, I can find all the currents, and that is the common way of the easiest way of solving it. So, we will first assume the BJT to be active. The moment I do that, I can apply KVL in the base to emitter loop. I can write then VBB as IB times RB plus VB plus IB into beta plus 1 times IRE. IB into beta plus 1 is nothing but the IE flowing here. So, once I do this, I can rearrange and find IB as VBB minus VB by RB plus beta plus 1 times RE. Once I find the value of IB, I can find IC to be beta times IB and IE to be beta plus 1 times IB. So, at the end of this step, I would have known all the currents, assuming the BJT is active. Now, this is an extremely important thing. You need to verify whether our assumption is right. To do that, we need to write an equation, again KVL for the output loop. Now, for the output loop, the KVL equation is nothing but VCC is equal to ICRC plus VC plus VE. Now, assuming active, we can write VC as VCC minus ICRC, VE as IERE. Then I can write VCE as VC minus VE. Now, if VCE, if I get at this step VCE to be greater than VC sat, which is 0.2, then my assumption was right. Then the BJT is active. If that condition is not satisfied, then you would see that the BJT is in saturation. Now, if in saturation, then two equations are required, one for the input loop and one for the output loop. And we can then use the equation IE is equal to IC plus IB. So, we have three unknowns and three equations, and it can be solved. Again, I have given one problem, one numerical problem in the assignment. So, I hope you do it, where you will be able to understand how the interplay of this. Now, before we end, I want to talk about the interplay of the role of RC and RE. Now, as I said previously, if you look at the circuit here, we would see that RC has a very, very important role to play in the mode of operation of the BJT. RC cannot be anything, but at the same time, one of the most commonly encountered misconceptions from the student side is that if RC is extremely small, let us say if RC is 0, if I ask a question whether the transistor will operate, most of the time students would say the transistor will not operate. But if you remember the models we used earlier, we saw that the collector current was modeled as a controlled current source, and it was entirely controlled by VBE. So, as long as this particular voltage here VC is greater than the voltage is required to ensure that this is reverse biased, it will work. That is important thing to remember. So, therefore, at the same time, if you keep increasing RC, we would see that the value of VC will keep dropping, and at one point VCE would become equal to VC sat or less than VC sat. So, therefore, RC has a very big role to play. So, in a amplifier circuit, you cannot choose RC arbitrarily. Now, again, I have included one problem in the assignment, where I asked you to choose the maximum value of RC possible in a given circuit. Now, similarly, RE has a role, but it is a bit tricky here. The role of RE is a bit more tricky, because in the previous case, RC, because this was a controlled current source, and since current, the collector current was not dependent on anything else other than the voltage at the collector, there was no problem. But the moment you touch RE, the whole scenario changes. Now, interesting thing to notice here is for the RC case, we had a situation where RC had an upper limit. You cannot increase it beyond a certain value. You can keep it as, we could keep it 0, not for an amplifier, but for a DC operation you could keep it 0, but RC cannot be increased above a certain value. But in the case of RE, it is the other way. If you keep increasing RE, nothing will happen. The transistor will be still in active region, but since RE has a role in determining the IB value, the currents will all reduce. If you increase RE, what will happen is that if you keep increasing RE, the base current will decrease, the collector current will decrease, the emitter current will decrease, but the transistor will continue to be in active region. So, increasing RE is no problem, but if you decrease RE, you see that IB will increase, which will increase IC, which will increase IE. So, we will reach a scenario where the increased, if you keep increasing, if you keep decreasing RE, the currents will keep increasing, and at a stage the transistor can enter saturation. Again, I have not included a problem because it is tricky, but it is important to remember that for RE you have a lower limit. So, for a given circuit, your RE has a lower limit, whereas RC has an upper limit. This is extremely important when you design an amplifier circuit. So, I have reached the end of my lecture. Just before I stop, let me just talk about a very good reference book which we very commonly use as a textbook here. Now, all this material, most of the material which I covered today was mostly taken from this reference book, Sedra and Smith, Microelectronic Circuits, 5th edition. It is an Indian edition, available very easily, and it is an extremely useful textbook as compared to the commonly used textbook in most engineering colleges, Milman and Halkias. Unfortunately, that is a very old book, and it was correct maybe technology wise 30 years ago, but today most of the materials mentioned in Milman and Halkias is not accurate. So, I think that is not a good book to follow, but this is an extremely good book to follow. So, let us wind up, just have a quick summary of all that we did so far. We talked about the BJT modes of operation, we saw the 4 modes, and we said active region is the most commonly used mode, and we said for the active mode of operation, you need to keep the base emitter or the emitter base junction forward biased, the collector base junction reverse biased, and we said for all amplifiers, circuits and so on, that is the mode, and we will see more of that in the next lecture. And we also talked about saturation region, which is one of the most confusing mode of operation, where both the junctions get reverse biased, and we saw how that particular mode of operation can be explained easily using a very simple but elegant circuit, BJT inverter. And I find that an extremely good circuit to explain the concept of saturation to students. We also saw that cutoff, that if the base emitter junction does not get sufficient forward bias, the circuit, the BJT goes into cutoff mode. And we also said there is a mode called reverse active mode, which is almost say never used except in logic circuits, and that is a situation where you could think of active mode where the collector and the emitter terminals are interchanged. And then we saw the ICVC characteristics, we also saw the relationships between the currents, and in the ICVC characteristics we saw that the currents are on a first order approximation, the collector current as long as it is above VC sat, it is constant, but then we saw that once you increase VC, the current slowly increases, which we said is what is called the early effect, and we talked about an early voltage. And we also saw the input characteristics in the common emitter mode, where we said that the input current varies exponentially. And finally, we saw the base emitter, we saw the common emitter biasing circuit, and where we explained again how we actually work out the currents and voltages. Now, in the assignment which I have which we will upload soon, I have included Ebert small equations, and I have given a number of scenarios. If you work it out, I can guarantee you, you would understand all the modes of operation thoroughly, including reverse active mode, and all that you need is a calculator. And please assume you can use approximations, but you would find that extremely useful. And I have included again one problem on BJT inverter and two or three problems on BJT DC circuits.